हेलो गाइस, आई होप यू ऑल आर डूइंग गुड। आई एम वैशाली की कान एंड वी आर डिस्कसिंग द VLSI टेक्नोलॉजी। इन दैट वी आर डिस्कसिंग थर्मल प्रोसेसेस एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू फोकस अपॉन द हाई टेम्परेचर डेपोजिशन प्रोसेस। ओके, सो आई होप यू ऑल हैव सीन द प्रीवियसली डिस्कस्ड हाई टेम्परेचर प्रोसेस like the oxidation process and the diffusion process. If you have still not watched the previous videos, I recommend you to go there and build up your concepts first and then come to this video. So today we are going to talk about the high temperature deposition process, and for that you need to understand what is CVD. CVD stands for the chemical vapor deposition. Now we have to understand the high temperature deposition process. For that we should know what is CVD. We should understand the meaning of this word in detail. Okay, what it needs to do, what it has to do with the IC fabrication, that we are going to understand. Okay, so in the CVD we have the gases or we have the vapors which are reacting over the substrate. Okay, so now wherever we want to deposit the thin film or wherever we want to deposit one layer over the substrate, we will be having some chemical reaction in between the gases or the vapors. Okay, so what happens when the gases or vapors are chemically reacting? There is two possibility: either it will be forming solid or it will not be giving any solid byproduct. But in the deposition process it is necessary that one of the byproduct is solid. Okay, so the solid byproduct goes on the substrate and it deposit on the substrate. Okay, and the other byproduct, which is mostly gaseous byproduct, it evaporates out. Okay, and this is how we are getting the deposited thin layer. Okay, so in the chemical vapor deposition, gases or vapors are chemically reacting on the substrate surface and they are forming the solid byproducts on the surface as a deposited thin film. Other byproducts are gases and they leave the surface. It is widely used in IC processing for metal dielectric and silicon thin film deposition. Okay, so for all three of them, for metal deposition, for dielectric deposition and for silicon thin film deposition, we are using the CVD or the high temperature thermal deposition process. Okay, so from here you must have understood what is the advantage or what is the need of high temperature deposition process. So if I talk about the high temperature CVD, I can classify it as epitaxy, polysilicon or silicon nitride. I can grow the epitaxial layer with the help of CVD, I can grow the polysilicon layer as well as I can grow the silicon nitride layer with the help of the chemical vapor deposition. Now coming to the epitaxy, I hope you remember what is the epitaxial layer. Okay, so if you have still any kind of doubt, go to the basic lecture on the epitaxy and there you will be getting a detailed understanding about the epitaxy. Because of the time constraints, I cannot discuss the epitaxy here again. Okay, so now epitaxy is a simple thin layer of the same type of material like the silicon on the silicon. Okay, so we are growing the monocrystalline layer. Epitaxy can be done with the silicon, with the silicon germanium and with the gallium arsenide as well. So we can have various types of epitaxial layer: silicon, silicon germanium and the gallium arsenide layer. So now coming to the epitaxy with the silicon layer, so what we need to do, we need to make a high quality silicon substrate without trace amount of oxygen and carbon, and for that we are making the epitaxial layer. The substrate was not having very good purity, it was having the contamination with the oxygen and with the carbon atoms. So we need to avoid this possibility, and for that we are using the epitaxial layer, which is a very pure layer. Okay, so this is the benefit of having the epitaxial layer. So it will be giving me high quality silicon layer over the silicon substrate only. So it is required for bipolar devices. Whenever I want to make the bipolar devices, I will be going for silicon epitaxy. It is needed for high performance CMOS devices as well. So now coming to the temperature requirement, so it is a high temperature process. The temperature requirements are nearly 1000 degrees Celsius. So what are the source gases? I have already told you, we have some gases which are chemically reacting and they are forming some solid byproduct. Okay, so what are these gases? These gases can be silane, SiH4, dichlorosilane, SiH2Cl2, or trichlorosilane, SiHCl3. So all of them can be acting as the source gases. Okay, and they will be reacting or chemically reacting over the substrate and they will be forming the silicon epitaxial layer. So here I will be using the hydrogen gas as the process and the purge gas. And if I want to have the dopant inside this epitaxial silicon layer, so I will be using the arsine ASH3 for arsine as a dopant. If I want the phosphorus as a dopant, I will be using phosphine PH3, and I can use the diborane B2H6 if I want to have the boron as a dopant. So we are coming to the various reactions that are taking place. As I have already told you, there are some series of reactions which are taking place to form the epitaxial layer. So these are the reactions. Actually, I have already discussed these reactions when I was discussing the epitaxial layer as well. So if I am using the silane, so silane will be dissociating at a high heat. So whenever I am giving the high heat around the 1000 degrees Celsius, so silane will be dissociating to form the epitaxial silicon and the hydrogen. This hydrogen is in the gaseous form and it will be going away from the substrate. It is a vapor type of or gaseous type of byproduct. Now coming to the dichlorosilane as the source gas. So whenever I am giving the dichlorosilane, so here I will be having the dichlorosilane which will be dissociating at a high temperature to give the silicon. This silicon will be going and depositing on the substrate, and this is actually the epitaxial silicon, and the rest byproduct is hydrochloride. So this is also in the gaseous form. So here we will be having Si plus 2HCl as the byproduct. One is solid and one is gaseous byproduct. Now coming to the dopants. Now if I want N type of dopant, for N type of dopant, as I have already told you, I was using arsine. Arsine will be dissociating at a high temperature. So ASH3 will be dissociating to form AS and 3/2H2. So here also we are getting the hydrogen gas. So this will be going away from the substrate and the arsine will be giving me required dopant concentration. So similarly, the phosphine. So here this is actually phosphine. Please correct this thing. And the phosphine will also be dissociating at a high temperature, like the 1000 degrees Celsius. It will be giving me phosphorus and 3/2H2. Okay, so here also this phosphorus will be giving me the required amount of dopant. Now coming to the P type of dopant. Okay, so here for the P type of dopant, I have already told you I will be using the diborane. Diborane will be dissociating at a high heat to form the boron and the hydrogen. This hydrogen is also in the gaseous form. Boron is in the solid form. It will be going inside the substrate, the epitaxial silicon layer, and it will be giving the required dopant concentration. So now this deposition or the epitaxial layer deposition is usually done by the wafer manufacturer instead of the IC fabricator. Okay, so it is coming in the wafer manufacture part only. So in the wafer processing or manufacturing part, I am getting the epitaxial layer and then I am giving it to the IC fabrication. So in fabrication epitaxial process, we require some special needs such as dopant concentration and the epitaxial thickness. Both of them must be accurately maintained. Okay, so I require a particular epitaxial layer thickness only, and I require a particular concentration of dopant inside this epitaxial layer only. So I require the selective epitaxial for raised source and drain. So that is also done in the manufacture, wafer manufacture part only. So sometimes I will be having some raised epitaxial layer as well. Then we have the single wafer epitaxy process. So now coming to the polysilicon deposition. Again, the polysilicon is deposited at a high temperature, so it is also a high temperature deposition process. Okay, so when I talk about polysilicon is having the high temperature stability, it is having a good conductivity as well, so it can be widely used for the gate as well as local interconnection in the MOS devices. Also, it is widely used as a capacitor electrodes in the memory devices, especially in the DRAM. So you can see here, you can see where the polysilicon is used. So you can see this is my polysilicon one. It is used as the gate. So here we have this sidewall spacer. Okay, so here you can see here also it is used. The polysilicon is used to actually in between two sidewall spacers. Okay, so now here we can see the polysilicon is used here as well, above the BST layer. So polysilicon can be used as a coating on the downward layer as well. Okay, so these are all of the application of the polysilicon in the DRAM. So it is again a high temperature process, as I have already told you. It is occurring at around 700 degrees Celsius. So it is occurring in a furnace and it is LPCVD process. Okay, so the source gases again here are silane SiH4 or dichlorosilane SiH2Cl2. So nitrogen will be used here as the purge gas, and I can use arsine, phosphine and the diborane like in the deposition of the silicon or the epitaxial silicon layer. So in the similar manner, I will be using arsine, phosphine and the diborane as the dopant gases. Okay. So we will be having the similar reaction. The silane will be dissociating to form the silicon and the hydrogen at a high temperature like 750 degrees Celsius. The dichlorosilane also dissociate to give silicon and the hydrochloride at the 750 degrees Celsius. So this silicon is in the solid form and it will be going and it will be depositing. So what I have observed, I have just reduced the temperature. The reactions are same. What I was getting in the epitaxial silicon layer growth, okay, that reactions are exactly the same, but the temperature is different. So there I was doing the epitaxial layer deposition at the 1000 degrees Celsius. Here I am doing it at the 750 degrees Celsius. So this is the difference. So again, the polysilicon doping will be n-type. For n-type, I will be having the arsine and the phosphine. For arsine, the reaction will be same. Arsine will be dissociating to give arsine plus arsenic plus 3/2 hydrogen. So this will be giving me required dopant concentration of the arsenic. Similarly, the phosphine will be dissociating to form phosphorus and 3/2 H2. It will be a gaseous hydrogen. It will be going away from the substrate. So you can see the temperature. It is also a low temperature process comparative. The low temperature is comparative to the epitaxial silicon layer growth, but this is also a high temperature. 750 degrees Celsius is not a low temperature. Remember it, I am saying it is a low temperature in respect to the epitaxial layer of the silicon. Okay, so for the p-type dopant, I will be using the diborane. We will be having the same reaction. Diborane will be dissociating to form boron and the hydrogen gas at a high temperature like the 750 degrees Celsius. So coming to the temperature relationship of the silane process, if I am changing the temperature, I will be getting the different output as we have already seen. Okay, so on a single crystal silicon substrate, if I am using silane as a source gas and if I have the temperature greater than 900 degrees Celsius, like in the first case, I took the temperature to be 1000 degrees Celsius. So in that case, we were depositing the single crystal silicon layer. Okay, so when the temperature is in between 550 to 900 degrees Celsius, we were depositing polysilicon layer. The temperature is less than 550 degrees Celsius, we were depositing amorphous silicon layer. So this is how, if I just change the temperature, I will be having different type of the epitaxial layer growth. So you can see at the temperature lesser than 550 degrees Celsius, I will be getting amorphous silicon growth. If the temperature is in between 550 to 900 degrees Celsius, I will be getting the polysilicon growth. At a temperature greater than 900 degrees Celsius, I will be getting single crystal silicon growth. So here you can see this is my LPCVD polycrystalline system. Okay, so for the polycrystalline, I am taking the temperature around 750 degree Celsius. I am taking the silane gas and I will be taking the process nitrogen and the purge nitrogen. The process nitrogen is a very pure nitrogen. The purge nitrogen can be having the purity level lesser than the process nitrogen. Okay, here we will be having the control valves and this is my regulator. So here I will be having the multiple wafers present in the process tubes. Okay, so this is a batch process. Now after this we have a burn box and the scrubber and the exhaust. Okay, so now I hope you understood the full system. Okay, now we are going to understand the polysilicon deposition process. So first of all, we are filling our tube with the purge nitrogen gas. Okay, so we will be having the idle tube with the purge nitrogen flow. Okay, we are not placing any wafer, we just have the flow of purge nitrogen gas. Then we will be flowing the process nitrogen gas. Again, we are not sending the wafers inside. After sending the process nitrogen, then we are loading the wafers into the tower with process nitrogen flow. Then the tower raises into the process chamber with the process nitrogen flow. So now we are having only the process nitrogen flow only, and we are raising the tower inside the process chamber, which is a bell kind of jar. So after that we will be pumping down the chamber to a base pressure. Okay, so we are maintaining the base pressure, which is lesser than 2 millitorr, by turning off the nitrogen flow. So when we are not having the nitrogen flow, the pressure will decrease. After that we will be stabilizing the wafer temperature with nitrogen flow, and again we will be checking the leak. Okay, so there should not be any kind of leakage into this system. After that we will be setting up the process pressure, which is nearly around the 250 millitorr, and after that we are sending the nitrogen flow again. So you can see what is the difference between the pressure. Here the pressure is lesser than the 2 millitorr, and here the pressure is around 250 millitorr, and this is how we have increased the pressure. After that we are turning on the silane flow, and then we will be turning off the nitrogen so that the silane would be there ambient in the environment, and after the silane is present mostly in the environment, it will be mostly silane related environment which is present in surrounding to the wafer, and there will be the dissociation of the silane to form the from the epitaxial layer of the silicon. Okay, so we will be closing the gate valves, we will be filling the nitrogen, and then we will be ramping up the pressure to the atmospheric pressure. Okay, so now after that we will be lowering down the tower, and the wafer temperature will be cooled down with the process nitrogen flow. After that we will be unloading the wafer, and we will be having the process nitrogen flow still there. After that we will be having just the purge nitrogen flow, and we will be moving back to the first step again. Okay, so this is the full process for the polysilicon deposition. Okay, so you can see we have various stages: load wafer, raise tower, pump down, temperature stabilization, pump down, pressure stabilization, silicon nitride deposition, pump down, nitrogen vent, lower tower, and unload wafer. You can see the temperature of the chamber is constant throughout. Okay, whatever temperature we want. If I want to deposit single crystal silicon, I will be having this stabilized temperature to be around 1000 degrees Celsius. If I want to deposit the polycrystalline silicon, the temperature will be around 750 degrees Celsius. You can see the wafer temperature will be first having constant, because here we didn't have the wafer to be loaded. We are just loading the wafer. After that we are having increase in the temperature, then again somewhat increase in the temperature, and after that at the temperature stabilization phase we will be having the stabilized temperature, and we are unloading the wafer, lowering the tower and unloading the wafer. There the temperature will be coming down. So you can see the nitrogen flow. The nitrogen flow will be decreased when I am doing the pump down. Okay, so at the pump down, to reduce the pressure, I will be having the reduced nitrogen flow. Again here also, to pump down, I will be reducing the nitrogen flow. If I am removing the nitrogen, the pressure would be lesser. Okay, So you can see it here. We will be having the lesser nitrogen flow in the silicon nitride deposition and the again in the pump down phase. The silane flow will be higher only in the silicon nitride deposition. Okay, the chamber pressure, again the chamber pressure is fluctuating. As I have already told you, it would be lesser in the pump down. Okay, here also we have pump down and here also we have pump down. It would be higher in rest of the phases. Okay, you can see the wafer tower position. The wafer tower position is going upward here and the wafer tower position is going downward here. Okay, so here we are raising the tower and here we are lowering the tower. So you can see the polyside deposition system over here. This is our deposition system. This is completely a robotic system. Okay, so here you can see we have the wafer loading stations. Okay, so this is my wafer transfer robot which will be transferring the wafer from one station to the another station. Okay, so here we will be having the cool down chamber. Okay, so we will be having the deposition chamber. This is my deposition chamber. After that, we have the polysilicon deposition chamber. This was my the tungsten silicide deposition chamber. Okay, this is also my tungsten silicide deposition chamber. So this is the polyside deposition chamber. The temperature would be around 750 degrees Celsius. So here you can see we have a RTA chamber that we have used. So when I have the wafer loading here, this is my wafer transfer robot. As I have already told you, this is my polysilicon deposition chamber. Okay, so here we will be having the tungsten silicide deposition chamber and here I will be having the rapid thermal annealing chamber. Okay, so I need to do the annealing also sometimes. Okay, so for that I will be using one annealing chamber as well. So coming to the silicon nitride is a dense material. So it is widely used as a diffusion barrier layer and it is widely used as a passivation layer as well. So for the diffusion barrier, it is giving me those areas where diffusion won't be happening. Okay, and the passivation layer means it is protecting the surface from the environment. Okay, so it is used as both a surface diffusion barrier and the passivation layer as well. So it can be done with the help of LPCVD and front end, and for the back end I will be using the PECVD process. LPCVD nitride are usually deposited inside the furnace. So coming to the applications of the silicon nitride, we have various applications of the silicon nitride like the locus formation as the oxygen diffusion barrier. Okay, so we will be having the local oxidation of the silicon formation. I have already discussed about it and again I will be showing you the picture also. Then it can be used for the shallow trench isolation formation as the oxide CMP will be stopping. Okay, so after the chemical mechanical polishing will be stopping, I will be having the shallow trench isolation formation with the help of the silicon nitride. After that, it would be used for the PMD barrier layer formation, or it can be used for the etch stop layer as well. Okay, so you can see the locus process. In the locus process, firstly we are having the pad oxidation layer. This is the thin layer of the pad oxidation. After that we have the nitride deposition. This pink deposited layer is the nitride deposited layer, and after that we will be doing the patterning. This is the mask, or this is the pattern that we have formed with the help of photolithography process. After that we will be having the local oxidation of the silicon. So we will be growing the SiO2 layer, and after that we will be stripping off the nitride as well as the pad oxide layer. Okay, so you can see this is the bird beak that we have formed, and I have already discussed about the locus process. It is used for the isolation of the two devices. Okay, so here if I want to isolate this layer and this layer, I will be using the locus, or I can use the shallow trench isolation. Okay, so here you can see we have the pad oxidation. This is my pad oxidation layer, this gray layer, and above that this pink layer is the nitride layer. Okay, so I have used the LPCVD process to form the nitride layer. After that I will be having the patterning process. For that I will be using the photolithography process and the photoresist over here. After that, I will be stripping off the photoresist, and here I will be getting the patterned silicon. Okay, so after that, I will be doing the trenching on the silicon. Okay, so here you can see we have formed this trench. Okay, after that, we will be having the barrier oxidation, and after that, we will be having the CVD USG trench fill. So here I am filling this full layer, and I am filling this trench also with the USG. Okay, so after that we will be stripping off the oxide, the nitride, this pad oxide, this nitride and the extra USG layer, and so that I will be having this shallow trench isolation formation. So you can see we have the self-aligned contact edge stop. So here you can see here we have this to be my polysilicon gate. Okay, after that this is my sidewall spacer. Okay, and this is my oxide layer. Above that we have this pink layer to be the nitride layer, and here we will be having the borophosphosilicate glass. Over that we will be having the photoresist. So now the etching process will be stopping with the help of this deposition process only. Okay, so when I have this layer, this extra layer will be stopping the etching process. If I want to etch over here, if I have this layer of silicon nitride, it will be stopping this etching from this layer also. Okay, so after that we will be having the nitride breakthrough. Okay, when I want to etch out here, I will be having the nitride breakthrough as well. Okay, so after that I will be stripping off the photoresist. So here the structure would be looking like this. I won't be having this photoresist layer over here. After that we will be having the deposition phase of the titanium or the titanium nitride or the tungsten. Okay, so you can see we have the tungsten or the thin layer or the coating of titanium or the titanium nitride. You will be understanding why I am having this titanium nitride coating when I will be discussing about the metallization. Okay, after that we will be having the chemical metallical polishing of the tungsten. So the excess tungsten will be removed, and also the titanium nitride and the titanium will be removed which is in the excess. So you can see we have various applications of the silicon nitride. You can see we have the silicon nitride layer over here. Okay, so you can see we can have the uppermost layer to be the silicon nitride layer as well. We have already understood where at all places the silicon nitride was used. So I hope you remember all of the ways where the silicon nitride will be used. It is a good isolator, so we can use its property as an isolator and we can use it for various purposes. Again, now coming to the deposition of the silicon nitride, silane or the dichlorosilane will be used as the silicon source. Okay, so if I want silicon, I will be using the silane or the dichlorosilane. NH3 will be used as the nitrogen source. The nitrogen will be used as the purge gas. So you can see the reaction 3SiH2Cl2 plus 4NH3 will be giving me the nitride, the silicon nitride plus 6HCl plus 6H2. Okay, or I can have the second reaction where I am using the silane. So here this reaction was with the dichlorosilane. Dichlorosilane is reacting with the ammonia to form the silicon nitride with the hydrochloride and the hydrogen gas. Okay, here also the silane will be reacting with the ammonia to form the silicon nitride and the hydrogen gas. Okay, so this is the system for the formation of the silicon nitride. Okay, so this is LPCVD system that we have. Okay, here we will be having the vertical furnace. So this is the difference from the polysilicon deposition system. Okay, so this is the vertical process chamber that we have. So this is a tower like of structure, and here we will be having the horizontally arranged wafers. These are my heaters, and here we will be having the various controllers. These are my controllers, these are my control walls, and this is my regulator. Here we will be having the purged nitrogen, ammonia, the process nitrogen and the dichlorosilane. I can use the silane as well over here. Okay, after there we will be having a pump, burn box, scrubber and the exhaust system. So all of them are used for the process of the deposition of the silicon nitride. Okay, so again you can see the all of the stages. The chamber temperature will always be stabilized. The wafer temperature will be increased. At the temperature stabilized point, it will be stabilized. So when we are loading the wafer, after that we are raising the temperature and it will be stabilized from this point up till the lowering tower point. Okay, after that the nitrogen flow, I will be reducing the nitrogen flow whenever I will be reducing the pressure. Okay, so in the pump down phase, I will be reducing the nitrogen flow. Okay, here also we have reduced nitrogen flow. Okay, you can see the NH3 flow, the ammonia flow will be high at the process stabilization and the nitride deposition phase. Okay, now coming to the dichlorosilane flow. The dichlorosilane flow will be higher only at the nitride deposition point. Okay, now coming to the chamber pressure. The chamber pressure will be reduced whenever we have the pump down phase. Okay, so here at the pump down, here at the pump down, and here at the pump down, the chamber pressure will be reduced. You can see we are raising the tower, and here it is. You can see it is showing the raised tower position. Okay, here we are lowering the tower. So now future trends of high temperature chemical vapor deposition. Now we are moving towards more single wafer rapid thermal chemical vapor deposition. It is required to have the integrated processes in the cluster tool. Okay, so these are the summary for the furnace deposition. The polysilicon and the silicon nitride are the two most commonly film deposited in a high temperature furnace. We have talked about both of them. Okay, so now I hope you understand the full process and the full furnace and the full system over which we can form the polysilicon and the silicon nitride epitaxial layer. Silane and the dichlorosilane are the two most commonly used silicon sources. Polysilicon can be doped while deposition by flowing phosphine, arsine and the diborane. So now I hope you understood all of them. If I want to have the source gases, the first thing that should be coming to your mind should be silane and the dichlorosilane. And polysilicon will be doped with the help of phosphine, arsine and diborane for the n-type and as well as p-type of impurities. So these are the references. These are really amazing book. If you want to read this topic in great detail, you can refer these books. Okay. So I hope you understood each and everything that I have discussed. If you have any further query, you can put the query in the comment and I will be trying to resolve your query as soon as possible. I hope you like this session. If you like it, please push the like button, subscribe to the channel and also do share it with your friends. Thank you so much.